Chiediamo la santa protezione della
Vergine. We call the protection of the Holy Queen, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou amongst women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now at the hour of our death. Amen. So I answered saying yes to the request that the general responsibles asked me to do a teaching in this event. But I need you to understand as I thought. So it's easier that I will become Pope than you. My name will be sixth, Pope Sixth. So it's like if it was the first teaching of after my nomination as Pope as Sixth. The encyclic.
Encyclic. The Pope letter.
So after the teaching, you will find the Swiss guard that will give you for free all the teaching. So you have not to take notes, but you have just to listen. I'm helped by a brother of the community. This brother will put the phrases of the Bible here on the screen. My encyclic is a biblical encyclic. My teaching is a biblical teaching. I start making some premises. After these premises, that will be very deep, I will start my teaching. When the pandemic started in 2020, I prepare myself to be locked in my room, and I started to buy some books. Then I started also with the literature, but the first book I bought was a sociology about Christian phenomenon from a Catholic sociologist, Franco Garelli. So the title is about the uncertainty of Christianity in Italy. So you will understand the reason why I will tell some things instead of others. In the beginning of this book, Garelli says, the Christian Catholic world is living like a shadow made by three profiles. The first profile is a shaded religious, then Catholics discontinuous, not always active, and cultural Catholics. So linked to the church, but just because they are located, influenced by the church, not because they are believers. Cultural Catholics, because they are born in a place that is Catholic. The most important touching thing of this report is that in a certain point Benedict XVI said Pope Benedict said that that the kind of relativism, ecumenical religion, a religiosity to get together Muslim, Christians and so on, kind of melted religion. There was a check a few years ago amongst the Catholics, and it was discovered that not many believed at the resurrection. So many Catholics don't believe the resurrection. So it's a kind of melted religiosity. In this book, again, it is mentioned that this kind of believers lives like so they live so they a lot of Catholics lives a lot of doubts and skepticism, so they are not believers, but full of doubts, full of mixed believing. In this time of liquid Christian culture, but more than liquid is gaseous, this socialist since 1990, the religious faith, different from the Catholic, were involving few people, just 2%. But just after 10 years, this presence of other religion rather than the Catholicism are over 5%, and now it's over 8%, just in 10 years. A witness of Jehovah create another witness of Jehovah, the same for the evangelical, but maybe a brother, sister of Magnificat is doing another person linked with the Magnificat or not? Do you announce the gospel or not? The beauty of COVID is that you cannot see anymore witness of Jehovah. With the COVID, they stay home. So, but witness of Jehovah are oriented to mission, but maybe it's not the same for us. In a right way or in a non-right way, maybe we are too much polite and we don't gain anybody to the Lord. We don't add any new faithful to the Lord. Here we are living big changes. In my diocese, maybe 60,000 people. When in 1976 I got to seminar, we had 92 priests. In 1984, 83 priests. In 1992, 57 priests. In 2003, 51 priests. In 2020, 36 priests. From more than 80 to 36. If this priest will last another 10 years, in 10 years we'll have eight priests, 19 years old, lot of this priest will be very old. so not active. Then maybe we have a 5 priests, 60 years old, 7, 50 years old, 4, so totally 15 priests, totally 15 priests just active. So we'll announce the Christian. So many are against the presence of clericalism and priest, but at the end of the day, without priest, the witnessing and the mission will be reduced a lot. Don't think in quantity, but in a unity. Today I led to the Lord one, maybe tomorrow I will lead a new brother. So don't think about big crowds, but at least single brother and sister to be led to the Lord with our witnessing, with our mission. I'm a priest since 40 years. And about the priest, people say that the priests are expert of God. The priest is a familiar of God. The priest knows like the secrets of God because of this familiarity with God. But we could add something else. A priest like me is not just an expert of God, and I hope to be like that, but is also an expert of humanity. The priest is an expert of humanity. I have a lot of books, but the bibliothèque of the people I met is much bigger than my library with all the books. I would say that what I met, some are like walls falling down. Many people are walls falling down because of their issues, their passions, their economical issues, division in the family. Walls falling down, destroying. Looks to me also, I see also men and women rebuilding, but there's not just people reducing and people increasing. But most of the people I know are men and women set on the ruins of their life, complaining a lot without doing anything to rebuild. Most of the people are part of this group. People set on their ruins, on their walls destroyed, complaining a lot, but without any will of doing anything to build and rebuild their life. Here we mention a phrase, prisoners in a well without water. This is the verse that I feel, you know, in this unstable situation, God find us like Israel in Babylon, prisoners in a well without waters. And he comes, God comes and make us prisoners of hope, like Zachary says. God find us prisoners in a well without water, but he take us out, making us prisoners of the hope. Zachary 9:12. So we are not free, we are slave of hope. The big gift of hope is desired when you read the prophet Baruch. Okay. Is the prophet of Baruch. Baruch 5157. Sì, sì, qua. Is Baruch chapter 5 verses 1, 5 and 7. God asked this: take off, O Jerusalem, the garment of your sorrow and troubles, and put on your beauty and the honor of that eternal glory which you have from God. You need to get rid of a pessimism, of being negative. Then arise, O Jerusalem, and stand in exaltation, and look around toward the east, and see your sun gathering together from the rising of the sun to the... So the Lord asks us to look at east after getting rid of being negative and after having stood up. We have not to be negative because we met the Lord, of course. That's why we need to take off the garment of your sorrow. Take off the garment of your sorrow. It's not possible that the meeting the Lord removed this sorrow. You need to take off that garment. Ephesians 1:17. Cos'è? I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. Grazie. Grazie. We cannot be negative because of this gift received from the Lord, because of this gift. Maybe now you will laugh a bit. One of the biggest enemies of our faith is the negative thinking, because the negative thinking get asleep the faith. If you are negative about how the church will be, how the future will be, how my life will be, how my work will be, how my faith will be, you will get asleep more and more. And so the discomfort thinking will come on you, and the discouraging will come on you. But also the thinking of the politically correct that is getting usually the politically correct thinking is do not exaggerate, make some compromises. But all this thinking to be regular is getting asleep our faith. And so this negative thinking is like a vampire that take away the blood from our life and make us asleep. So this negative thinking, the negative person get asleep, is not awake. Like when Saint Augustine had to follow Platon or Saint Ambrose, and he feel himself almost asleep, a bit awake, but a bit asleep. And this was what Saint Augustine lived when he has to choose Plato or Saint Ambrose. So this negative way, the vampire also inject a liquid that make ourselves more asleep. That's why all the negative get deeply and deeply in the sleeping. And the vampire can extract all the life from us. But we have met Jesus that awakened. Jesus awake, make us awake. And Jesus inject hope, not the negative thinking. Now, listen to this great idea that I found. In the Bible, we can note that the lack of hope, grows in the exile land, where Israel is exiled and without hope is in the exile. But is exactly in the exile when the people of Israel receive the word of Baruch, that word of hope. So remember that when you leave the desperation, God tell you the words of hope. So hope grows close the place where you are desperate. So we are all in exile. Exile from myself, for example. But for instance, we can also say the exile is living where I don't want to live, or living a feeling that I want to feel, or having expectation that are always disattended, being always frustrated. All these situations make us living an exile condition. And so we can fall in the thinking negative, with the vampire taking from us anything, or listening and remembering what God said through Baruch. That is, I am like a prisoner in a well without water, but God will make us prisoners of hope. Not hoping is like when we think negative, we are close to the death of our faith, and we are close to the death in our life. If I will have a new nephew, I would like him to be named Isidoro. Isidoro says that hope has this meaning in Latin. Spes is like op. Spes comes from pes. Pes like foot in Latin. So hope has the etymology, the root of foot. So to get away from desperation, you have to make a piece of walk. You have to walk. You have to use your foot. If you want hope, you have to use your feet and walk. You have to walk over the debt. This is important. I'm an expert of humanity, as I was saying. Many times I met people that had life destroyed. So imagine that we have an earthquake and all my library comes down with all the books. What can you do? Are you getting desperate? No. Get right the library and just put one book, then another one, then another, and so on. So don't pretend, don't try to fix anything. Just do a foot, one walk. So get the library right again and just put one book and then another one. So that's why Isidoro teaches us this. So just put one foot, one step, and the Lord will take you away from this well without water. And Jesus is our hope. We make the first step, and the Lord will take myself from this well without water. So we cannot be without hope, but we have even to transfer this hope. Here I say, Peter, when he wrote the letter, I was wondering, why, Peter, have you asked to put in your hearts, sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you and accounting for the hope that is in you. So we should always be ready to give the reason of our hope. I hoped in the Lord, and he bowed on me, he kneeled on me. Get rid of the garment of sorrow. Then, here is a stand up on the hill. In Baruch we say that to flatten the mountains, to fill the holes, is something that will be done by God. You have just to take off of the garment of your sorrow, and then most of the job will be done by the Lord. The first thing that you have to do is take off, O Jerusalem, the garment of your sorrow and troubles, and arise, O Jerusalem, and stand in exaltation. Standing up is like, it means, is the opposite of stay horizontal or laid in a bed. But if you are horizontal, you see just the things that are close. But if you stand up, you can see also the things that are very far. From the top, you can see, you can have a more open overview. If you stay down, if you stay down, your problem looks very big when they are not. So you need to see all the context. In this way, you will understand more the real magnitude of your issues. That's why it's important to stay on top. If you stay down, there's no light. If you stay on top, you have light, and you see all the context. If you stay down, you see just your work. If you stay on top, you see also the work of God, and you have a more real overview of anything. That's why Baruch says, stand up, stay on top. Baruch also saying other things. He says, look around. Baruch says, look around, in the verse 5.
Io
Baruch, you say to us, look, but maybe we are too much people that look. We look everywhere. We look Netflix. We look media. But Baruch say, look just towards east. So the point is not to look everywhere, but is to look towards the east, where the sun comes. Look towards the east, not south, northwest. Look towards east. And we know the meaning of east. When someone is lost, we say that someone has lost the direction. So when a man loses the heading, fails in his life. So we lose the heading if we look in every direction. If we lose the direction, we are desperate. But we need just to look at east, look towards east. But because the sun comes from east, so if we look at east, we look in front of us, not behind us. So if you look to east, you explore the dreams of God, where the sun comes. I know myself quite well. I want to stay on top, and I stay on top because I'm a priest. A priest with a lot, big desire not fulfilled. So I'm obliged to see in front of me, because all of myself is not fulfilled since I met the Lord. So I cannot look behind. I'm not stupid. I need to look in front of me where the sun comes. So the Lord is staring on me, and I want to do the same. I spent a lot of months with the Evangelical Pentecostal, because this was my first experience in 1973 when I was 16. And so I am one of the first charismatic person in Italy, because in 1973, I had the grace of the invasion of the Holy Spirit inside of me. And so these experiences were done with the Evangelical Pentecostal. And sometimes a bit of the Evangelical Pentecostal experience remained me, like the reading of the Bible. So if you read the Bible, it's like when you put your hand in Nutella. And so we have to be like that when we read the Bible, not small spoon of cream. No, we have to eat the Bible as we would eat a Nutella, the chocolate cream, so very with the open hand. And these evangelical brothers and sisters tell us a lot about the Bible. For example, Caleb. Is anyone here that never heard about Caleb? Today you will listen about Caleb. But how many of us have understood speaking a lot about Caleb? Caleb is one of the 12 sent by Moses. Caleb was a friend of Joshua. They will get in the promised land, just Caleb and Joshua, because Caleb and Joshua saw towards east, where milk and honey spring. The other 10 looked behind. They said, why we don't get back to Egypt? But Caleb and Joshua acted in a different way.
Qual è? Questo numero è 14:14.
Numeri?
14:14.
Is coming from the book of Numbers.
Qua.
Numeri 13.
Questo 13.
We came to the land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Yet the people who live in the land are strong, and the towns are fortified and very large, and beside is so the descendant of Anak there. I like this passages, phrases, because it's very realistic. Caleb doesn't see just honey and milk and Nutella, but also the issues, the strong people there, the Amalek people, the Amalek, it is just, but Caleb. And Caleb said, let us go up at once and occupy it, for we are well able to overcome it. But the not wise people, then all the congregation raised a loud cry. And the people wept that night. And all the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword?" The one that think in a negative way, the one that doesn't look towards east, no one of them got in the land where flows milk and honey. Just Joshua and Caleb went to the land with milk and honey. But why, Caleb, you had this sight towards east? Because Caleb was full of enthusiasm. Sometimes I know what is living my faith with enthusiasm. And the enthusiasm is a grace coming from heaven. It's not an emotion or a shape, a part of our psychology. A man that is not enthusiast, a man that is without enthusiasm, is always thinking negative, saying our community are not longer authentic, our priests are not as saint as it was, and so on. And the vampire comes, so the enthusiasm is not a part of our psychology. You are enthusiasm if you are in love with God. If you are in love with God, you are also enthusiast, because enthusiasm comes from the Holy Spirit, from the Spirit of God. If you study in an attentive way the Bible, where it is spoken about enthusiasm and power, Holy Spirit and power, you can find the So the one who gives you the Spirit and make wonders in midst of you, like Galatians 3:5. The one that gives you Spirit and makes wonders in midst of you. So the enthusiasm is the Holy Spirit that invade you and make and allow you to make wonders. And in Hebrews, it is said that God used to witness in the same way with the sign and wonders and miracles of every kind and gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed following the will of God. So the enthusiasm of Caleb is this, the Holy Spirit. And so this evangelical that made this study about Caleb made a study coming from the book of Numbers 14:24. Caleb was animated by another spirit, so it was not a matter of muscles or human strength. Caleb was invaded by another spirit, and so we'll be like Caleb if we will be animated by another spirit. So, to everybody will happen to lose the enthusiasm. But we lose the enthusiasm when we are tired? No. We lose the enthusiasm when we are in retirement? No. Do we lose the enthusiasm when the pressure gets high? No. Do we lose enthusiasm when we are with diabetes? No. The enthusiasm gets away when we are without Holy Spirit. This is what the Bible say. In the Bible, the Holy Spirit doesn't mean that we are a superhero, invincible, without issues, because the second letter, Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 10. I rejoice in my sickness, in my issues, in my needs, persecutions, anxieties that I live for Christ, because it's when I'm weak that I'm strong. So it's not a matter of being superhuman or super charismatic, no. And the thing that touches the most about Caleb, have you ever read what about Caleb is said? Joshua 14, 11. Joshua 14, 11. So Caleb is old. Dove sta? He has issues of diabetes because of the a lot of honey. 14, 11. 14, 11. I am still as strong today as I was on the day that Moses sent me. My strength now is as my strength was then, for war and for going and coming. So, who said that he's living in the renewal of the Holy Spirit since 40 years? So you need to read this. So during Israel walking in the desert, so, I am, he says, I'm 85 years old, but I am still as strong today as I was on the day that Moses sent me. My strength now is as my strength was then, for war and for going and coming. So it was 85, but it was feeling himself as strong as it was when Moses sent him many, many years before. But he had not the Holy Spirit storaged or stored somewhere, like Obelix with a magic potion, with a magic poison. So you know that the druid made the magic drink. And so if you wanted to defeat the Romans, it was enough to drink the magic drink. But the druid was against giving again the soup to Obelix, because he fell inside when he was very, very young. Asterix, the small one, received the magic drink because it's not the same experience of Obelix. So it's not like Obelix for us. So the day of the effusion, we received all the Holy Spirit, one and forever. No, we are like Asterix, like the small one. So every time before any new battle, we need to go to drink to the spring of the Holy Spirit, to the source of the Holy Spirit, to find again the strength we need. So we have not to think that you are an everlasting charismatic. No, we are not Obelix, we are Asterix, we are the small one. Every time we have to start a fight, we need to drink at the source of the Holy Spirit. I become strong and I defeat them. But the thing that touches me most, like Caleb that was animated by the Holy Spirit, is keeping being an explorer. So Caleb was old, but was still an explorer. He was looking for new battle, new places, new location. And we need to be the same. We need to keep and to be explorers for new location, new wins. So the biggest battle to be won, the biggest battle to be won is against our disbelief. The biggest battle that we need to win is the one against our disbelief. It's so important and so difficult to keep the faith as it is, believing and being Christians with the firm belief. We have to be convinced, Christian. Here he's saying a fact. A person said to him, so he said that he saw in an appendix of Ratzinger where there was the report of. There was, it is mentioning a conference in which Pope Benedict in 1968, Ratzinger was saying, Ratzinger in a conference in 1968, so this German man where the secularism, so the reduction of the faith, Ratzinger was saying, at his beginning, the church was founded on the spiritual decision of individual people to the faith, on conversion act, individual conversion act. But even if Christian, it was not in this way perfect, and the community of saints remained always with the issues. The church was a community of convinced people. So even if they were not all saints, but they were convinced. So even if you are not the best, you can be convinced. It was composed by people that had taken on themselves a spiritual decision, and they used to feel themselves different, not the best, but different from all the other ones that refused this decision. So the community, magnificent community, has to be composed by convinced people, not the best people, but convinced. If you are called by the Lord, you are different from the others that refuse to be part of the flock of Jesus. So if you are not convinced, you don't contribute to anything. The point is not to be the best, the point is to be convinced. Convinced of what? Convinced of what? We have to be convinced to be what we are, and what we are, You are the salt of the land, of earth. You are the light of the world. Not you should be, but you are. You are the salt of earth, and you are the light of the world. Not you should be, but you are. And so we have to be convinced that we are the salt of earth and the light of the world. Matthew chapter 5:11-16. So the point is, you are and not you should be. I see a risk in my church, and is to be just salt. The reading of my Catholic Church. That's why I would be the Pope the sixth, and write this encyclical, because Christians are not called to be just salt, but salt and light. So, Jesus, with these words, explain the location for the Christians in the world is to be in the world, like salt in the paste, in the bread, and on top of the world, like light. So this part of the gospel is that you have to be inside of the world, like the salt, and so mixing with the sinners, Muslim, whatever you want. You have to be salt if you are mixed, but also you have to be light. So in Philippians, you have to be righteous, easy, son of God, pure, in the midst of this perverted generation in which you have to shine like stars in the world. So you have to be salt, but also that light, that pure light, like immaculate and pure sons in the midst of this perverted generation. And we have to shine like the stars in the sky. So, have you heard about Zaki? No, Zaki is a Copt Egyptian, Christian Egyptian. Years ago, the bishop of the Copt, they were edited all the teachings of this bishop, all the teachings of this bishop, Copt, have been published. But you need to read the content of this teaching that was made by this Copt bishop. And what he was told by this bishop was very, very strong. In this teaching, this bishop will say, if you are not a convinced Christian, just the Muslim will remain. And the teaching of this Abba are much, much, much stronger than the teaching we are used to. And this Abba, speaking about the strategy of the devil, it says this. The devil is like a maker of cords. With these cords, he set the nets to hunt the man. And Satan is very much patient. He can shot a man in one time, or he can set a plan that can last for 5, 10, or more years to have him falling in the sin, or he get his thinking, his will, his feeling in a not direct way to arrive to have this man falling. So be careful at yourself. If you don't understand that you have the same enthusiasm that you had long time ago, and no love and no control of yourself and perseverance and fidelity and commandments and the skill to win the sin, then you should reflect on yourself, and you should know that the enemy has led you to the lower levels, and stopped to make you light, but just salt. So you have to be careful with the devil, that is very patient. And at the end of the day, the way to understand if you are in trouble is the lack of enthusiasm. So if you have not enthusiasm, be careful, because maybe you are hurried and you need the help of God. So you have not to be just salt, but also light. So once Father Livio obeyed the sin, and so he went to Don Pietrino for a confession. This Don Pietrino used to confess 1 or 2 hours. So this Don Livio went to confession. Don Pietrino said, Livio, you have to walk at high level, walk on top, like when you walk on the mountains. So if you come to me for a confession, I will tell you, walk at high level, walk on top, walk on the peak of the mountains, don't walk down. And so Don Pietrino used to say, if you fly at the lower level, you make your wings dirty because you touch your wings with the earth, with the mud. And so when the wings are heavy, you cannot fly anymore. So we have to be salt and light, and we have to walk on high levels. We have to walk on the peak of the mountains. We have to stay high with our wings clean and not dirty because they touch the mud that happens when we fly at lower levels. There was a story said by Kierkegaard. It was a great philosopher. Speaking about this level, so he added that there was a duck, wild duck, and during the autumn, this duck saw a lot of some ducks, domestic ducks, and so it was attracted by this duck in the farm, and so he was thinking, if I go to this domestic duck, I can convert them to have them to fly instead of being in the farm. So he was thinking, I can convert this duck that are in the farm to have them again flying like me. And so when he went to this domestic duck, these domestic duck were fascinated in the beginning by the possibility to fly, but after a while they started to get annoyed, and so this wild duck, instead of converting the domestic duck, she was converted to being domestic instead of being wild, and instead of flying, and instead of having the domestic duck converted to be wild and fly, was the wild duck to be converted to be domestic, and this wild duck got back and started to be domestic at earth, just walking, not flying like the domestic duck. The end of Catholic Church are the Christians with the partita IVA, come si dice? With the VAT number. So are the Christians with their own job. So it's like
small business.
Yes. So if we are Christians that care just about our small business, we cannot be Christian together, heading to the big targets. From the letter of Diognetos, dove sta? We are in the questa è bellissima, tra l'altro conosco. Ce l'hai?
C'è un pezzo di
From the Letter of Diogneto.
Questa è una citazione, ma è lunga.
Non so. So the difference between the Christians and the pagans is that the Christians share the table and not the bed, but the pagans share the bed and not the table. The Christian witness a way of living social, beautiful and undoubtful. Christian are indistinguishable from other men, either by nationality, language or custom.
They follow some outlandish way of life.
Okay. And follow some outlandish way of life. So the life is beautiful, but surely a paradox. It's paradox because it's a nonsense. It's not reasonable following the thinking of the world. What is paradox for us Christian is surely being certain and enthusiast. Hallelujah.